And I'm going to just go through a few things that I think we ought to be focused on, as we even during these Trump years. One is, as progressives, we need to stand aggressively working to end war and prevent conflicts from escalating. And by the way, Congress ought to do its job. You know, under the Constitution, we ought not to be at war unless Congress votes for the authorization of the use of military force. We have not done that. We have involved in wars in Iraq and Afghanistan and Yemen and now in Syria. I read in the paper that Trump's sending another 1,000 American troops to Syria. You know what? That's called mission creep. And Congress ought to do its job. If you believe that we should have endless war, then you ought to vote for it. If you don't, like me, then you ought to vote no. Enough of these wars. And we ought to be talking about reducing the military budget and not increasing it. Number of nuclear weapons we have in our arsenal. It means whether people have jobs, whether people have housing, whether people have enough food, whether people can afford to go to college, whether or not we have a solid infrastructure. We need to stand for repairing and modernizing our infrastructure. Here in Massachusetts, we have bridges older than most of the other states in this country. They are falling apart. If somebody can tell me how to repair a bridge for nothing, I'm all ears. But we need to invest in upgrading not only our roads and our bridges, but our transportation systems, our airports. And here's one thing I would like us to commit to. I want us to commit to building the best, the most effective, the finest railway system all across the country. Has a roof over their heads, that they have food on their tables, that they have affordable health care. Food, shelter, health care are rights, they are not privileges. There are too many people in this country who are suffering from hunger. We have 42 million Americans. 42 million Americans in this country who are food insecure or hungry. We are the richest country in the history of the world. As the United States Congressman, as a citizen of this country, I am ashamed of that reality. And what makes it so maddening is that this is an issue we can solve. We have the resources, we have the infrastructure, we have everything but the political will. Hunger, homelessness, is a political condition, and we need to develop the political will and the political backbone to insist that we put the resources in to solve these problems. Healthcare. So, Keith and I are relieved today because it was because of the persuasive speeches that we gave that resulted in them pulling that horrendous repeal and replace bill. The reality is it was you. Yes. And it was people like you all across the country who called in, who called not just Democrats, and every single Democrat was ready to vote the right way, but called into Republican offices. And by the way, they were hemorrhaging votes, not just from the Freedom Caucus, who thought the bill wasn't bad enough. They were hemorrhaging votes from moderate Republicans. People like you were showing up to their town meetings and saying that you will not forget if they vote for a bill to throw 24 million Americans off of health insurance. You will not forget if they pass a bill that denies you essential health benefits. Imagine that, to sweeten this bill up, to try to win votes, they actually introduced language that said insurance companies will no longer be required to provide you packages with essential health benefits, like emergency room service, like mental health benefits, like treatment for people who are addicted to opiates and heroin, like maternity care, all those, you know, radical things that so many of us take for granted, they wanted to take away. That is who they are. And I will tell you that it is not just progressives. I think it's decent Americans who are repulsed by that kind of by those kinds of actions.
Thank you very much. Maybe you felt it at airports when people were standing up for their nation. I even kind of felt it a little bit when we did that sit-in after that horrific shooting in the House floor.
That's your homegirl right here.
And that spirit, I can feel it growing. I can feel it coming together and congealing. And that spirit of activism, of commitment, of patriotism, not the chauvinistic kind, but the love of country kind. That spirit is now kind of gathering and saying, we've got to be on the streets, but pretty soon we've got to convert it into an electoral game.
That's it.
Yeah.
You've got to get that street energy and move it into the ballot box.
Yeah.
Understanding that the bread box and the ballot box are connected. And if we don't connect them, people who are out to deny us the bread box will also deny us the ballot box. The fact is, you guys, there is every reason to be hopeful, even though it must feel, after Trump was elected, like we're all in a collective, you know, nightmare. It is true that, yes, there's Paul Manafort out there, scary as he is, but there's also Jim McGovern. There's Steve Bannon, he's there. But we also got John Lewis. We're not wearing rose-colored glasses around here. But I'm gonna tell you, there is a lot of reason to hope. And one of the most important ones is that people are not saying, why don't you leaders up there figure out a way to help us? No, the people are organizing themselves. People are using social media and good old door knocking and neighborhood connection to build this mighty movement that Jim is gonna make us a better country than we've ever been before. It's true. You know, has anybody ever heard of something called Prop 187, which was an initiative in California?
Yeah.
Y'all heard of that? For those of you who never heard of it, Back in the day, not today, you look over at California and Massachusetts and a few other states and you got progressive legislation. But back in these days, California was known for three strikes, you're out, building prisons everywhere, a lot of anti-immigrant stuff, a lot of anti-LGBT stuff. And Prop 187 said, we are not going to allow people who don't have documentation to get health services, education services, any kind of services. We're going to deny them. Lock them out. And the idea was that if we lock them out, maybe they will go home. Problem was, all these growers that want cheap labor were pulling them in, all at the same time. Well, Prop 187 actually passed. And people in California who have been activists and they've been fighting their whole lives for human dignity, fair pay, and civil rights for all were crushed. But then the next morning they said, you know what? We're not going to live in this dark night of the soul forever. We're going to get ourselves together. Mm-hmm. We're going to put on our walking shoes. We're going to lace up our sneakers. We're going to connect to our neighbors. We're going to talk to people who we hadn't talked to before. We're going to go into the neighbors where some people are scared to go into. We're going to talk to those folks on the end of the block we hadn't talked to before. And we're going to get them and organize them into a mighty force. And we're going to change the state of California. And I'm telling you, right now, California has some of the best environmental legislation in the country. California has some of the best legislation. They just passed in Los Angeles County a tax bill. They'll tax them themselves so that they can house the homeless, so that they can build transportation. What I'm trying to tell you right now is this is a tough time for America, but it doesn't have to stay that way. The only danger you and I really are under is if we take the victory that we experienced yesterday and say, whew, glad that's over. No, we have got to build progressive infrastructure. And it's not exciting. And it's not glamorous. It's hard work. It's day in and it's day out. Yes, we've got to get involved in party structures. And I'm telling you right now, one of the reasons I ran for chair of the Democratic National Committee is so that I can help infuse that institution with a new spirit of activism. Yeah. We had about four debates and we had a bunch of other informal debates And we went all over the country, and we talked, and we shared ideas. And by the end of it, hey, look, you know, absolutely, I wanted to win, but it didn't come out the way I wanted to. But we were very close, very, very close. And yet, Tom Perez says, turns to me after the vote's over, he says, you know what? Man, we got to unify this party. We need everybody here. We don't want anybody feeling defeated or pushed out or unneeded. Would you be the deputy chair of the Democratic Party? I said, sure I will. And I said this because I know that we have got to unify. Disunity can kill us. Look at these Republicans forming their circular firing squad, shooting each other dead. They all get right. We're not sad about it, but I'm telling you, look at the circular firing squad that they have created. We can't do that. We've got to come together. And that means that we've got to have tolerance for different points of view that all occupy, from the moderate to the left. And we've got to find common ground. And we've got to come together on the things we can come together around. And we certainly can. Yeah. You know, every Democrat I've ever met believes that our seniors have to have dignified retirement and believe in Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Yeah. We all believe that. Do we? Do we? Yeah.